key to the Nashville sound were the studio session musicians and background vocalists, who became collectively known as the A-Team. Chet Atkins and Owen Bradley used the A-Team on virtually all of their recordings. As many as 4 songs could be cut during each 3-hour recording session. It was Nashville's version of production line pop.
One time, I got so busy that I bought a 4-inch thick piece of foam rubber, the size of a mattress. And if I got through at 3 or 4 in the morning and I had another session, say at 9 in the morning, I'd roll it out and lay down there right in the booth where my bass was. And I didn't have to worry about waking up because the engineers would come in an hour before the session and banging things around, wake me up. And I'd get some coffee and go right back to work.
Owen Bradley would take the winning formula of the Nashville sound and apply it to childhood singing phenomenon, Brenda Lee. I didn't know love could be so cruel.
Oh, 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 yeah. The song I'm Sorry happens to be a very simple song. It was only an 8-bar song, which you need 16 bars for a song. So we went into the studio and all the musicians were saying, how are we going to make this song a 16-bar song? And a couple of the guys said, well, we'll do a little instrumental type thing. Owen said, if I remember correctly, it was either Owen or my manager, said, why don't we do a recitation and make it a 16-bar song? So we said, okay.
I'm sorry. So sorry. Please accept.
We had 10 minutes to do the song, to do a head arrangement with everybody contributing. I did it in 2 takes. We put it out in June of 1960. Within a month to 6 weeks, it was number 1 on the charts, and it sold 15 million records worldwide as of today.
And I was too blind to see.
The new, polished sound perfectly reflected the rising aspirations of millions of Americans who had moved to the suburbs of 50s America. Country music may have become conservative and safe, but it had succeeded in appealing to a mainstream audience that didn't go out drinking every night. The cattle are prowling, the coyotes are howling. More than any other artist, Eddie Arnold, reminiscent of a country Bing Crosby, represented country music's evolution from honky-tonk to unashamedly country pop.
I had a drop-off with my sales. And as we say in this country, I got a little cold. And so that's when I decided to go in and record with violins, seriously. And I got lucky with it. And I had a whole new career.
Eddie Arnold had grown up even poorer than Hank Williams, but unlike Hank, Eddie wanted to move upmarket and join the country club. He traded his cowboy hat for a tuxedo and made music for the living room rather than the bar.
Tears will fall like petals when we part. I begged you to be different, but you'll always...
Look at one of his major hits, Bouquet of Roses. I'm sending you a big bouquet of roses. Now notice that. It's not, I'm picking you off the rose bush some flowers. It's, It's having the florist send them. That implies a certain level of sophistication, of financial autonomy, you know, discretionary cash, and a certain ritual of courtship etiquette. That's far from the farm.
Country could only make big money if it crossed over onto pop radio. So if you have Make the World Go Away by Eddie Arnold on the same charts as the Beatles and the Rolling Stones, then you could sell in big numbers. It was strictly, wasn't strictly, but it was mainly economic. That's how you survived. The country audience could give you a base of support, but economically you needed that pop crossover to get the big sales, to sell a million copies.
I started making records in 1945. I just know that I've had a good run. And I'm up now to around almost 90 million. I had to do something right.
Put your sweet lips a little closer to the phone.
Only Jim Reeves could top Eddie Arnold's crossover appeal. He'll Have to Go would become Reeves' signature tune, a tour de force of Nashville sound production values. The one-time farm boy was now an international superstar. Jim Reeves, along with his Nashville contemporaries, had succeeded in transforming country music from its rural roots into a global mass market phenomenon.
Love me true, or is he...
Jim Reeves died in a plane crash on the 31st of July, 1964, almost 12 years on from the untimely death of Hank Williams.
Make up your mind, I've got to know.
In the time between these two tragic events, country music had irrevocably changed, leading some hardcore fans to claim that it had sold its soul.
What had happened, I think, between the late 40s and the middle 60s, this era we're talking about, country reached a wider audience, sold a lot more records. What it did was survive the crisis of rock and roll, that this was the birth of the Nashville sound. But in the process, the old-time hardline country fan was a little disappointed with what it became, I think.
The new music was sort of designed not to offend anybody. And the problem with that is when you make music that's designed intentionally not to offend people, is the end result is usually that you don't make anybody feel anything. And that's sort of the antithesis of what music is supposed to be about to me. So it was a weird time.
Even Ray Price, the proud defender of honky-tonk music in the 50s, was attracted to the gloss of the Nashville sound, abruptly shifting from beer hall shuffles to lush, string-laden ballads.
Ladies and gentlemen, Ray Price and Danny Boy.
In 1967, his recording of Danny Boy created a stir comparable to Bob Dylan going electric.
Oh, Danny Boy, the pipes. The pipes are calling.
I wanted it different because it's such a great song. And I used part of the Nashville Symphony and jumped right out into the fire. They gave me a lot of hell over that. Said I had deserted country music and wasn't country anymore.
Horrified fans at San Antonio's musical arena trashed the Texas venue. 32 fans were arrested as Price, country music's very own Judas, tried to pitch his voice above the fray.
And I must buy. But come here, bud.
I had some of the fans spit on me. You know, they was really damning about it. And I just looked at them like, you poor soul, you don't understand. But they paid their money to come in and hear me sing it. And that kind of messes with my head a little bit, you know.
I didn't care whether it's real country music or not. I was trying to sell records. It's like a baseball team. You're supposed to win. If you don't win, you're out of business. Just like always, I was in the studio trying to be successful as a recording artist. And I was.
But it was a little too much for my poor heart. Yesterday's memories tore me apart.
Eddie Arnold was certainly a winner, but the success of the Nashville Sound also left a string of losers in its wake. Chief among them, Hank Williams and his legacy. Hank, who'd sung about losers, had unmistakably become one himself, his music sidelined as too raw and unrefined for the slick and shiny new face that Nashville now exclusively wanted to show to the world.
Hank Williams Sr. was representational of the time. There really were guys, you know, riding the rails and you know, doing what Hank Williams Sr. did.
I'm a rolling stone, all alone and lone.
Some folks at the time like to point to the Nashville Sound and say, see, that's what killed country music. It used to be all of this great honky-tonk music, the music of Hank Williams, and now look what we're forced to listen to.
Well, actually, the Nashville Sound helped save country music. You know, people have said country music is dying for decades. It's got to be the longest disappearing act in the history of music.
Now, boys, don't start you rambling around.